Guys, you've probably heard of hydroxyapatite in your toothpaste and that it's a great and safe alternative to fluoride, but did you know that hydroxyapatite is currently not a regulated ingredient? So companies can make all sorts of claims about their hydroxyapatite product and create whatever kind of formula they want. But the truth is, in order for hydroxyapatite to be effective, it has to meet some very specific criteria. Let's talk about it. So before I dive into the details, let me give you guys a brief history of hydroxyapatite. So first of all, hydroxyapatite is a compound containing calcium and phosphate minerals. It's found naturally in our bones and in our teeth, and a consumable nanoparticle version was developed by NASA a little over 50 years ago to help astronauts with bone and tooth loss. Then a company in Japan called Sanji, bought the patent and started developing hydroxyapatite toothpaste, following the same science as NASA did, which I will get into a little bit. So, hydroxyapatite became the gold standard in Japan for cavity prevention over fluoride, which is a known dose-dependent toxin, meaning the more you consume, the more harmful it is to your body, despite the established benefits for cavity prevention. Now, eventually, hydroxyapatite as a toothpaste ingredient trickled over into the United States, but as I mentioned, there's a very specific criteria that hydroxyapatite has to follow in order for it to be effective in your toothpaste. So first, there's the particle size. There's micro versus nano. And second, the concentration matters. Also, the shape of the particles matters. So the most effective formula is it needs to be rod-shaped, nano-sized particles at a final concentration of 10%. So as I mentioned, hydroxyapatite is not regulated at this point, so companies follow all sorts of recipes and combinations of using like micro and nano-sized particles, different concentration percentages, potentially different particle shapes, not to mention the quality or source of the hydroxyapatite. And basically, they make all sorts of unverified claims about their product. Luckily, there are a few brands that do follow the exact science, and I'll get into those a little bit later. But before I talk about that, I want to discuss how the proper version of hydroxyapatite works to help your teeth, especially in comparison to fluoride, which is currently the standard for cavity prevention, at least in the US. So first, a brief recap of how fluoride works. So the key takeaway about fluoride is that on its own, it's not effective to prevent cavities. It needs the calcium and phosphate ions found in your saliva to bond with and form fluorapatite, which is then the ingredient that bonds to your teeth and helps to remineralize your teeth or your enamel on a surface level. So this is a pretty big problem if your saliva is not rich in calcium and phosphate ions, because to be exact, for every 2 fluoride ions, you need 10 calcium ions and 6 phosphate ions to create fluorapatite. So this is a problem, again, if your saliva doesn't have enough calcium or phosphate, or if you experience dry mouth, aka xerostomia, or if there's any sort of disbalance in your saliva with the pH or anything like that, again, compromising the amount of calcium and phosphate in it. This is actually why I often see patients who are using even prescription strength fluoride toothpaste and still get cavities, because their saliva is not adequate enough to help the fluoride turn into fluorapatite and help prevent the cavities. But anyway, I digress. So fluoride mixes with the calcium and phosphate ions in your saliva, forms fluorapatite, and helps to remineralize the enamel on a surface level. And again, keep that in mind, surface level. Now, in comparison, hydroxyapatite already has calcium and phosphate ions in it. It's made up of calcium and phosphate, so it doesn't depend on your saliva to be effective. And also, unlike fluoride, instead of depending on a good pH level of your saliva, it helps to rebalance your pH. This makes sense because instead of having to use or take up calcium and phosphate ions like fluoride, it actually introduces them into your mouth and into your saliva. By the way, if you guys are interested, I'll provide links to all the studies that I'm going off of in the description below. Also, by the way, if you guys are finding this video helpful so far, don't forget to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel for more videos like this. Now, this is where the exact science comes in. So at the optimal 10% nanoparticle sized hydroxyapatite, it penetrates the enamel on a deeper level, deeper than fluoride, which offers surface remineralization, and deeper than microhydroxyapatite particles, which are about 1,000 times bigger than nano-sized particles, meaning they're too big to even get into the pores. And by the way, before I get too far ahead of myself, even with the nano-sized particles, the ideal size is, I believe, 20 to 50 nanometers. There are actually larger sized nanoparticles as well, which again, as a non-regulated ingredient, companies can even say they use nano-sized particles, but the particles are still bigger than the most optimal size, which is 20 to 50 nanometers. The smaller the particle size, the more expensive. So it would make sense companies that advertise that they use nano-sized particles might still actually be using slightly larger size particles to save on cost. But again, that could compromise effectiveness. But anyway, so this 10% nanohydroxyapatite actually helps to rebuild the enamel on a microscopic level, repairing and smoothing out any microscopic roughness or scratches. Now, the smoother the enamel surface, the harder it is for biofilm and plaque to adhere to the tooth, and ultimately, the less incidence of staining. I've personally experienced this on my own teeth. I've had a couple of areas on my bottom canines and a couple of my just bottom teeth in general that always accumulate stain just because the enamel is super rough there. And over the months slash years of using hydroxyapatite toothpaste, I have noticed that that stain has virtually disappeared. That alone to me is just a huge testament of how well hydroxyapatite works, because I've always had this stain on my teeth for as long as I remember. So the fact that it's not there anymore just speaks volumes. And then also, the less stain on your teeth, the whiter your teeth appear. So bonus points there as well. In addition, because it penetrates the enamel on a deeper level, nanohydroxyapatite helps with sensitivity in a more thorough, permanent way than other anti-sensitivity toothpastes, which contain potassium nitrate to block the nerve from feeling sensitivity or pain, but it doesn't actually do anything to fix the source of the problem. So once you stop using that anti-sensitivity potassium nitrate toothpaste, the pain returns. On the contrary, nanohydroxyapatite actually helps to restore the enamel on a microscopic level, so you don't feel the cold or the pain, not because the nerve signal is blocked, but because the enamel is actually repaired. I keep saying on a microscopic level, because just to be clear, hydroxyapatite is not going to rebuild half of your tooth if, you know, you have a bombed out tooth with a major cavity. Think of it sort of like a scratch on an arm versus your entire arm chopped off, right? A scratch will heal, the entire arm will not grow back. So just to be clear, don't depend on your hydroxyapatite to rebuild half a tooth if it's missing. Just feel like I had to say that. One other thing I wanted to mention is you may have heard of MI paste. I've gotten a few comments about this as well, and how well does it stand up to fluoride versus hydroxyapatite. So in case you weren't aware, MI paste is another oral care product that contains calcium and phosphate ions, but nanohydroxyapatite actually outperforms MI paste because the calcium and phosphate ions in the MI paste aren't as readily available. The way they're bonded or formulated in nanohydroxyapatite is a more readily available version than the ones found in MI paste. So ultimately, it's more effective and outperforms MI paste. Again, I'll have links in the description below to all of this if you'd like to check that out for yourself. So anyway, now that you're empowered with all of this knowledge about hydroxyapatite and which version is more effective, the question is, what brands actually follow the science? So a few that I know of include Sanji, the brand that sort of pioneered hydroxyapatite in toothpaste. Their brand is called Apigard Royal. I haven't personally tried it myself, but I have heard of its effectiveness. There's also Vivartis, which is a Swiss brand. Switzerland equals Swiss, right? A brand from Switzerland. As well as Dr. Gen Natural, which is based in the United States. Now, I'm predicting that as things become more regulated and consumers become more aware of what hydroxyapatite is effective, more companies will start to reel it in and adhere to the actual science. For now, I encourage you guys to reach out to companies if there's a specific brand you're interested in. I usually just shoot them an email and be like, hey, what particle size do you guys use? What's your concentration in your final product? And quick caveat here, I'm saying final product because I discovered that some companies say they use 10% hydroxyapatite, but that's actually at the start of manufacturing, and by the time it gets into your tube of toothpaste, you're left with about 2-3% concentration. So leave them no wiggle room. If you're going to email companies about their formula, make sure to ask them what the concentration is in their final product. Now, in case you guys are wondering what brand I use, I personally have been using and love Dr. Gen's brand. First of all, as I mentioned, they follow the science. I actually see the results, and I've used a few other hydroxyapatite toothpaste before I tried Dr. Gen's, and results were very minimal and very slow. And once I started doing more research about hydroxyapatite, I realized why. Again, some of these companies just haven't been following the science. Though I have checked back on some of the brands that I've used in the past that weren't very effective, they have since changed their formula. But that being said, I just still really love Dr. Gen's for the results that I've been seeing. And even though, as I mentioned, Apigard Royal has been the pioneer and really the gold standard for science-backed hydroxyapatite Hydroxyapatite toothpaste, Dr. Jens just uses cleaner ingredients, which I'm all about. I actually found out that they formulated this toothpaste, the owners of Dr. Jens brand, with their daughter in mind, who had a lot of sensitivities and oral health issues, so they had to create a cleaner version. And if it's good enough for their daughter, it's great for me. On a quick side note, when I started using Dr. Jens toothpaste, I noticed that after brushing, my teeth would feel kind of fuzzy, almost like I didn't brush them well enough. And later, I was actually informed that that is to be expected, because what's happening is the hydroxyapatite crystals are bonding to the teeth and attaching to the enamel surface, causing them to feel kind of fuzzy. And over time, our saliva just kind of washes those crystals away and the fuzziness disappears. The truth is, I actually noticed after several weeks of using Dr. Jens toothpaste, that first initial fuzzy feeling went away, because I think it's been filling in my enamel pores and making the surface smoother, so another testament to it working. Now, just FYI, Dr. Jens also offers what they call super paste. It's actually a combination of hydroxyapatite and fluoride. There's a study that shows that combining the two actually delivers even better results at preventing cavities, which kind of makes sense because if the hydroxyapatite is providing the calcium and phosphate ions and there's fluoride, which needs those calcium and phosphate ions, it's more effective working together. Now, I personally have my reservations about fluoride, but for those of you who want the combo, which I know you're out there because I've gotten plenty of comments about combining these two ingredients for more effectiveness, Dr. Jens does offer this type of toothpaste called Super Paste. I'll leave a couple of links below to the specific products. Okay, last point I want to make. This technically goes for any toothpaste, but especially for hydroxyapatite toothpaste. In order for it to be effective, you need to keep it on your teeth. It takes a couple of minutes for the hydroxyapatite to chemically bond with your teeth. So basically, you're supposed to brush your teeth. You can spit all the excess out, but don't rinse. I personally have always found that a little bit gross, like you just brushed everything and the plaque is removed, but it's floating around in your mouth. So I like to brush, rinse, and then reapply a fresh bit of toothpaste all over my teeth and leave that in. But you do you. If you don't find that gross, then feel free to just brush, spit, and don't rinse. All right, if you guys have any further questions, feel free to comment them below and I'll get back to you as soon as possible. Otherwise, thank you so much for watching and I'll see you in the next video. Take care of your teeth.